ready.
You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song.
Yes, you are.
You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song.
I sing it again. You are so good to me, to heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are so good to me, to heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven.
You are beautiful.
You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated. Here's Catherine Fletcher for your announcements.
Good morning, everybody. Great to see you here today. I'm Catherine Fletcher. You can find me at the Welcome Center. If this is your first time here, please come by and see me. I have a nice gift for you that has information on the church in it. It also has our We Care cards, which is a great way for you to give us new information or update your information, submit prayer requests and praise reports, which our diaconates will pray over every week. So you can find those in the seat backs or at the Welcome Center. You can put them in the offering plate, or there is a box on the Welcome Center to drop those into. This evening, we'll be having Encounter. Dinner will start at 6 o'clock. I think we're having sweet and sour chicken. Thank you so much, Joseph. And then worship will start at 6:45 and share groups at 7:45. Again, we have a great event coming up, Friday, August 19th. We will have our Night of Praise featuring our very own wonderful praise band and Joey O. It is a free concert. It will start at, doors will open at 6:30, and the concert starts at 7. Coming up in September, we have our Fall Women's Bible Study, Armor of God. It will take place starting Tuesday, September 20th, and Wednesday, September 21st, Tuesday evenings and Wednesday mornings. You can sign up at the Welcome Center, and the materials are $15. Our food pantry is looking a little worse for wear, so let's start bringing some stuff in. Take advantage of those BOGOs and share with everyone here and get the food pantry looking good again. One last announcement. I am wearing a bracelet that was found in the parking lot, so it's a very pretty... So I'll have it at the Welcome Center if you did. Is it yours, Doug? Okay. It looks good for you. I like it. Good luck. that's all I have for today, everyone. So why don't we rise and shake a hand and say hello to everyone. Thank you.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all thy works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display.
Then sings my soul.
Then sings my soul. Savior God, to thee how great thou art,
sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
And when I think of God as Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in.
Kindergarten through fifth grade, you'll just, everyone, just go to the stage. Everyone.
Just all of them.
All of them.
All of them at once.
All of them at once.
They're gone. Okay, Gene's going to read our scripture. We have two scriptures, Matthew 5:5, and then we're going to read Matthew 11:28-30.
Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Matthew 11:28-30 says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light."
Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gifts and the blessings that you give to us every day. We thank you, like in the scripture, that we can come to you when we're tired and you will give us rest. And so we bring to you the things that wear us down, Lord, that we carry, that we know we should let go. And we bring those to you and we put them at your feet. Please be with us in our day and in our week to come. Just be with us as we face the challenges that come with life, with families and jobs and setbacks and disappointments. Lord, we know you're going to be with us, and we're always going to be fine with if you're with us, because we know you're our resolve and you are our strength in us, and only you can just renew us, Lord. And so we just pray. We come to you in worship this morning. That you continue to bless us. And we pray this in your Son's name, Jesus Christ, our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning, my church family.
Good morning.
You know, the more Susan and Keith and I are here, the more we realize that y'all indeed are our family and how blessed we are. And it just grows on us more and more each Sunday. In fact, this is the pinnacle of our week is coming here to worship on Sunday. So, you know, when I was growing up, and unfortunately I was in that same group, we used to always say, golly, it's Sunday, I got to go to church. But now we get to go to church. That's my attitude now. So praise God for the Son Jesus that opened the door that we can come into the throne of grace in time of need. And before I get started with the meditation, on behalf of the church, I really want to thank my brother Steve. I've heard him preach so many times on Sunday night with Encounter. And as I tell him each time, I don't think you can do any better than you did tonight. Well, y'all are in for a treat this morning, brothers. I'm telling you, he did a fantastic job this morning. I had the privilege of listening to him at 8:30 And as he told me, it's the Holy Spirit, and of course I know that, but he's the vehicle through which the Holy Spirit delivers, and we thank you, Steve, on behalf of the church. As we learn in Jesus' message from the third Beatitude today, from his Sermon on the Mount about the meek, one of the definitions of meek is submissive. By our being submissive or committing to Christ's care and control, we see what Jesus accomplished on the cross for us. And this assures us of his incredible compassion for us, and we can trust him to bring us through our struggles and with forgiveness and restoration. While they were eating on that night, he took some bread, and after blessing it, He broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take it, this is my body." And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." Stewards, please come forward. At this time, we welcome all believers in Christ to come to join us at the communion table. Thank you. Thank you, Donna, and we're glad to have you back. We've missed you, and we just thank you for the superb job you do. Now, as we come to this part of the service, we have a time, we're at a time where we can show our gratitude and just our thankfulness to Jesus for what he's done to us. And I just remind us that we can be submissive to him by doing what he's not suggested, but what he indeed has commanded, and that's to give 10% of our earnings. And being as compassionate as our Lord is, you know, he could have asked for 90 and we keep 10, but he did it the other way around. He only wants 10, we keep 90. So that's a win-win. So I just trust that, that at this time now we can just give back to the Lord for what so much he has done for us. And if he hadn't done anything else but send us his son Jesus, that would have been all, that's all we need, nothing else. But just think about the many other blessings and things he's given us. So thank you, Lord. Father God, we just thank you for these tithes and offerings. We ask you to bless them. And as our church now has a vision for not only reaching out among our own, but into the city of Venice, and indeed now we are contemplating taking part in your work in Guatemala. So, Father, bless these tithes and offerings so that they can amount to the amount we need to be able to do this work and to accomplish our vision, which is to love people, teach them the truth, to serve you, and then through all of that, Father God, we can have the privilege and opportunity to see you change the world one person at a time. Amen.
Please rise.
Stop fighting a fight that's already been won.
for I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain. I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed.
Some of you know my story. I moved to Florida 26 months ago, a little over 2 years. Not because I wanted to. Still not in love with Florida. I come from northern New England, was the last stop and whistle stop that I came from. When I left, my third marriage was in its twilight. Didn't have much anywhere to go, so I came down to live with family, start over once again. I hate starting over. How many times have I started over? And I was a mess. I had gotten into recovery several years ago, about 8 years ago, and I got off the track. So I came down here and started looking for work. I lived with family for a while, and tell you what, I found this church. I should say God found this church for me. Got into recovery meetings. Now he's given me a ministry. He's given me wonderful friends. Pray for me every day. People that I fellowship with. Give me a great job. I love my job. It was what I was meant to do. God is so good. He can redeem again and again and again. He's been so good to me. And you people are a big part of that. I love being here at this church. I love worshiping God here. I love the love that you people have for everybody. Doesn't matter how you dress, what kind of rock and roll you listen to, what kind of tattoos you wear, where you come from. We just love people. And that is a mark of this church, and I'm very grateful. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak to you this morning. I think maybe you kind of oversold it there, Mike. I hope not. Mike's one of my biggest fans. His wife is my biggest fan. It's good to be the king. You ever heard that? Louis XVI, History of the World, Part 1. Right? It's good to be the king. My lifetime, I've known of several kings who had the limelight for a while. And it's unfortunate that a lot of times what that does to somebody is it gets them more full of themselves. People who start out with good intentions, even good morals, even walking with God, and suddenly they get a taste of fame and fortune and power, and it starts to become all about them. Dr. Martin Luther King, he wasn't a king, it was his name. He was a Baptist preacher. All he ever wanted to do was preach. And God called him, and we all know his story. God used him in a mighty way. I have a CD of some of his sermons and excerpts, and I listen to him online. Great preacher of the gospel. And one of the sermons that he taught, one of the speeches he gave, he talked about how he was so discouraged one night back in the mid-50s when they were doing the boycott in Montgomery, and he was getting phone calls from people who wanted to hurt him, and he couldn't sleep one night. He got up, made some coffee, and he just sat at the table. He says, God, I can't do this. And so he put his faith, God reminded him of how he was going to take care of everything, how he was going to take care of Martin. And it's okay. You're doing what I asked you to do. I will empower you. I will be there. And he got his strength from God when he needed it most. He didn't set out to become Dr. King, but that's what God made him. God used him in a mighty way. He could have settled for being in a Baptist church his whole life and just preaching the gospel. God said, I have more for you to do. There was another king in my generation, king of rock and roll. Remember him? Died on his throne in 1977, some say. Drug overdose. Now, I understand Elvis was raised in the church. They say he got saved. I heard his brother several years later give a testimony to say Elvis was born again. I hope that he was. But what happens is you get popular, you get rich, and suddenly you forget where you came from, where you're supposed to be going. A few years ago, King of Pop, Michael Jackson, one of the most popular entertainers of all time, he died from drug complications. And he was raised in a good moral home, too. King Nebuchadnezzar in the Bible, remember him? He was warned. Three times God warned him. Three times God tried to show him. Remember, Daniel interpreted his dream, and he says, God bless the God of Daniel. Not my God, your God. And then the next time he built that big idol, and his three friends, Daniel's three friends, wouldn't worship it, and they threw him in the furnace, and they survived the furnace. And they came out, and he said, blessed be your God. Anybody who says or does anything against your God will be punished. But then what happened? God said, I want this guy on my side. He had to get to a place where he really knew God was God. He got up on the rooftop one day and he said, look, is this not the great Babylon that I have built with my own hands? He was struck with insanity. He said he walked around on the ground and ate grass like a cow for 7 years. But what does he say at the end? He said, this is so beautiful. At the end of 7 years, I raised my eyes to heaven, and my sanity was restored. Wow. When he finally humbled himself before God, he looked to God. God restored his sanity, restored his kingdom. Now he would call God his God. Now he's my God, the God that I worship. He had to get to that place in his life where he had to be humbled. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And I was studying this again. I've studied the Beatitudes for years, and it's some of the most important teaching, I think, in Scripture. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I get that. God says you humble yourself. You fall before him broken and say, you know, I can't do it. I am nothing without you. I have nothing. And God gives his kingdom to those people. And then blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. You cry over your sin. You repent. You weep. James says, weep, mourn, wail over your sin. And God brings comfort. I get that. But the meek, how do the meek inherit the earth? it seems to me, in our day and age, the meek don't inherit the earth. It's the powerful, the power grabbers, the people who step on the meek. Has anyone ever won a political office by being meek? I mean, we're in an election year. These people are calling each other names and slinging the mud. That's how you get ahead, right? God says, no, the meek are going to inherit the earth. All this is going to be theirs. The devil tried to tempt Jesus. I'll give you all this if you bow and humble yourself and worship me. Jesus said, no, that's not the way. There's a way that seems right to us, and in the end, it leads to death. God says the way to get up is to get down, to humble yourself, and be meek. I want to talk a little bit about another king in the Bible. His name was Saul. Remember the first king of Israel? Now, this man was full of the Holy Spirit. There was a time in his life where he prophesied and worshiped God, full of the Holy Spirit with the other prophets. When he was inaugurated, coronated as king, he was hiding among the luggage. He was kind of shy, quiet, meek guy, you know. But once he got a taste of being the king, read his story up through about, the whole book of 1 Samuel. He started to do things his way. It's good to be the king. I can do things my way. And so when Samuel approached him in chapter 15, and this is where I want to launch this, chapter 15, he said, I need you to go wipe out the Amalekites. Wipe them out. Joshua didn't get it done. They're supposed to wipe out all the people in the country. Didn't get it done. Go wipe them out. Kill everybody. The soldiers, the king, the men, the women, children, babies. Kill the animals. I don't want these people to have anything to do with my people, your holy people. Saul said, done. We'll get it done. So at the end of the day, Samuel comes in, says, did you obey the Lord? He says, you betcha. I obeyed the Lord. Wiped them out. Well, why do I hear these the sheep bleating and the cattle are lowing? Did you go out and get some sheep I don't know about? Well, guess what? We found these animals are perfect for sacrificing. Perfect. And so we saved them for sacrifice. Do you remember what I told you? I gave you the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord said, go wipe them out. Yeah, I did. Wipe them out. I mean, it saved the king, too. The king, I mean, he's the trophy, right? Got to save the trophy. And we saved the animals for sacrifice. I mean, doesn't God want good animals for sacrifice? Why waste it? There's a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to death. Samuel said, you didn't obey. But I did, and he argued with him. Folks, incomplete obedience is not really obedience. It's not total surrender. It's like a woman saying, I'm sort of pregnant. By the way, guys, never ask a woman if she's pregnant. That can't turn out well. Because what if she ain't? I mean... I'm kind of married. No. You either obey or you don't. You either surrender or you don't. There's no two ways about it. There's no partial about it. Saul said, but I did obey the Lord, 95%. You know what Samuel said? I want to read what Samuel said. Does the Lord delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as much as in obeying the Lord? To obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed is better than the fat of rams. For rebellion is like the sin of divination, and arrogance like the evil of idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. Now you're calling me a rebel? I get it 98%, right? You're calling me a rebel? For the 2%? You didn't obey. Doing God's work in your own way, it's not obedience. It's not about keeping a list of rules and do this. And believe me, for decades, I lived the Christian way and I lived my way, both. I can keep the rules. I can do this. And the Pharisees were like that, right? God expects me to do these 400-some things religiously. Paul gave his testimony in Philippians 3. You can read it. He said, it's concerning the law. I was perfect. I never broke any of the laws. Remember the rich young man that came to Jesus? I want to be your follower. Jesus said, well, you know the law. Keep the law. He gave him like five or six different things. Have you done these things? Oh, since I was a kid, I've been doing that. Well, you want to be my follower? Here's what you got to do. One more thing. You know what he said. Go home, sell everything you got, give the money to the poor, then come and follow me. And he couldn't do it because that was the one thing that he couldn't give up. The one thing he was unwilling to give over to God. You know, it's interesting how when people come to Jesus, I know when I come to Jesus, you're going to give me the one thing that means the most to you. And for each one of us, it's something different. It might be possessions, it might be relationships, it might be our job, something that means a lot. We have to be willing, because he knows. He knows if you can surrender that one thing, that you'll be willing to give up the rest. And he does truly give it back. He gives back to us. As an old saint that I used to know years ago, was a retired pastor. He was 95 when I last knew him 10 years ago. He said, when you give something to God, he'll either clean it up and give it back, or he'll give you something way better. People say, you got a good ministry, I like the way you speak and everything. I say, it's all God. A number of years ago, I gave it all to him, and this is what he gave back. That's all I can say. When you give it to him, he'll give you so much back. Remember, everything becomes new. The Bible says the old is gone, the new has come. So Saul, King Saul is arguing with Samuel here. Okay, you know what, Samuel, you're right. You're right. I got it wrong. I disobeyed. Fine. You want to call it disobedience? Fine. He didn't really repent, though. And God said, I'm taking your kingdom away, and I'm going to give it to someone else. And that's how we got King David. He was insincere. So what does it really mean to surrender? You know, this blessed are the meek, for theirs is the kingdom. No, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. What does it mean to be meek? What does it mean to really surrender, to come to that point in my life where I realize I can't do it on my own, and I don't only need God's help, I need God to take the whole thing. Start. How many times have we had people come into recovery meetings and say, I need a little help with my addiction? Help with your addiction. My wife tells me she's going to leave, I'm going to lose my job. I'm kind of coming unglued. I need God to help me. The thing is, I don't need God's help. What I need is a Savior. I need somebody to start all over. I need somebody to tear it all down, rebuild it back up. I need somebody to start right from the beginning. And that's what God's in the business of doing. You know, if you come to God with a problem and you say, God, I need your help with this, sometimes he'll help you. That's what I did for years. Sometimes he'll help you, and he'll give you maybe some fruit for your work and your ministry and things like that. But not like if you totally surrender. Where does it start? It starts by simply believing in Jesus. Can we have the next slide, please? Simply believe in Jesus. The crowd asked him, what must we do to do the work God requires? Jesus answered, the work of God is this, believe in the one who he sent. It's not about keeping a list of rules. It's not about doing your best. It's not about reading the Bible and go, okay, I can do that, I can do this and that. It starts out with believing in Jesus. You've got to put your faith in him. That's where the surrender starts. You're the Lord. I'm not the Lord anymore. I'm giving you the crown of my life, everything. You take it. That's where it starts. Jesus was asked this question, what is the greatest command? One of the teachers in the law asked him, of all the commandments, what's the most important? And you know, they had several hundred. The most important one, Jesus answered, he didn't even hesitate. The most important one is this. And he's quoting from Deuteronomy, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There's no commandment greater than these. Jesus boiled it down. Boy, I tell you what, if I could get those two down, I'd be a long way ahead of my Christian walk. If I could do that all the time. So it starts not with a list of rules. It starts with believing the one he sent, putting your faith in Jesus. loving God with everything you got, loving other people as much as you love yourself. You know, he's put that love in us. He's given us that love that redeems us. When we come and put our faith in him, he gives us his grace and his love, and he says, pay it forward. Love me as I've loved you, and love everybody else as much as you love yourself. That's what he says. So he's still speaking in generalities here. No specific obedience, okay? Because only out of a heart of obedience can we truly obey God. Only once we've surrendered can we truly do what he asked us to do. I don't want to be one of those people that gets to the end of my life and stands before Jesus in judgment. And he said that they will be there. He said many people will come and say, Lord, didn't we do all these good works in your name? We cast out demons. We healed the sick. We raised the dead. We fed the hungry. We gave money to the poor. We visited the prisoner and the sick. And he said, that's very kind of you, but I don't know who you are. I don't want to be one of those people. I want to have a heart that loves God and loves people, and out of that, to obey him and serve. It's so much in our society, it's about what you do. It's about posturing. It's about looking good. It's about looking the part, playing the part. Did it for years and years. It doesn't work. In the end, it doesn't work. What we do has to come out of a heart that loves God and loves others. So what does God require? It's in the book of Micah. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings and calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? Wow. He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. To act justly, to treat people with justice and fairness, the way God does. But to love mercy. To love mercy. Got to temper it. See, God is both just and merciful, right? He's all love, but he hates sin. Justice and mercy. This came into play in my job. I took a job 2 years ago as a high school teacher. I taught years and years ago, but it's a lot different in the 21st. And the kids started to get on my nerves. I'm a math teacher. Who likes their math teacher? Shay, thank you. Right. It's not personal. And so I'd get, you know, little arguments with the kids, and I started not liking them. The second year I started teaching, he said, pray for him. And there's another teacher that was with us last year that strong believer in Jesus. And we used to get together regularly and pray for our kids, pray for our fellow teachers and our administrators. Tell you what, my kids started to get real nice. But you know what? It wasn't the kids. It was my attitude. It was my attitude that I could start sharing the compassion of Christ every morning when I get up and say, God, let me show the compassion of Jesus to these kids no matter what. No matter what. I mean, they do wrong things, you still got to write them up and, you know, go the discipline way. But to show the love of Jesus to everybody you meet. And it's not just keeping the rules. If I go in there as a teacher and say, well, I got to keep the rules. I got to keep the, make sure they're not late to class, make sure that we're in uniforms and they're not giving me grief and they're doing their homework and everything. You know, if that's all there is, I'm not really being effective in my life. I got to love first. Starts with love. He's shown you. What does the Lord require? To act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. Every day, walking with God, being sensitive to his words to us, reading the word, meditating on the word, loving the word of God, filling my mind and my soul, marinating in it, as my friend Chuck would say, marinating my mind in the word of God. I've heard people say they read through the Bible in a year or 3 months, whatever. That's great. I think I did that once, but it means more to me to meditate. To pick a passage of scripture, a verse or chapter passage, and just meditate on it for week after week after week. I've got a group of a bunch of memory verses I carry around with me and every day of the month and in the morning, certain ones, and I just meditate on them because God's message to me. That's how God's getting through to me, to walk humbly with God, to pray, to seek his face each day. That's where it has to begin. Is your heart engaged? Psalm 40 was written by David. If we get up the next slide, please. Or, I'm sorry, Go back. I missed one, sorry. Brokenness. Brokenness. You do not delight in sacrifice. This is a prayer, David says. This is after he sinned. Remember he committed adultery and had her husband killed? You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, you, God, will not despise. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Remember, this is Jesus' first sermon. He's been walking around saying, repent, for the kingdom is at hand. Repent. That was the gospel of repentance that John was preaching. Jesus started out by saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are the meek. That's where it has to begin. David says, I could bring all the sacrifices in the world. Wouldn't matter. Remember, Paul said, I could give my body to be burned, but if I don't have love, it means nothing. That's where it starts. So let's go to the next one now. Is your heart engaged? Psalm 40. Sacrifice and offering you did not desire. Is this getting old? He keeps saying this again and again. But my ears you have opened. Burnt offerings and sin offerings you did not require. Then I said, here I am, I have come. It is written about me in the scroll. I desire to do your will, my God. Your law is within my heart. There you go, meditating on the word of God. And that part where he says, your ears, my ears you have opened. There's another translation of that. It says, my ear you have pierced. It goes back to the Levitical law. Every 7 years they had to free the slaves. A slave was free to go back to his master, though. If he liked the guy he worked for, remember? They would take him to the temple, and the priest would stick an awl through the lobe of the ear. This one is marked for life. He loves his master, and he wants to stay with his master. There's a beautiful song I heard years ago called Pierce My Ear, Lord. I want to be yours for life. It's about dedication. You do things for people because you're dedicated to them, because you love them. And when you start doing things, not because you love them, but because you're obligated, because you're feeling, I got to do this in order to get to heaven, I got to do this in order to look good, I got to do this in order to win a reward, that's the wrong motivation. It's got to come out of a heart of love. So let me sum it up. True obedience, surrender to God, is complete, willing, wholehearted, humble, and done from a heart of allegiance to the Lord. That's where it begins. It begins with the heart. I want to finish up with a couple of things. In the 40s, a young man was born in the Detroit area. His name was Vincent Furnier. And he got sick at a young age, probably like 5 years old. Got very sick. And his father was a pastor. And they prayed for him, and they believed that God healed him. They had to move to Phoenix to give him a better atmosphere so he wouldn't get sick a lot, I guess. And he grew up in that area. He went to high school, started hanging around with the wrong crowd, got into smoking and drinking and drugs, and started a rock and roll band. And they became very, very famous. And he started liking that lifestyle. Again, remember the king. King starts liking all this fame and fortune and popularity. It's all about me. Had a real bad drinking problem. And in the 80s, he finally went into rehab, got cleaned up from alcohol, got out, and somebody introduced him to cocaine. A couple years later, he went back into rehab for cocaine. This time, he came back to his faith. People had been praying for him. He came back to his faith and professed Jesus as Lord, and he gave his life. And now he still does the rock and roll thing. He's changed the lyrics to some of the new songs he's written. Same kind of music. But you don't know him as Vincent. He changed his name a while ago. Alice Cooper. Alice, he's one of us. He's in the church. Well, if God can save Alice, he can save me. You know, we need more freaks in the circus, right? Alice has a great testimony of what God's done in his life. He has a ministry to young people in Phoenix. He wrote the words of this song. About a man who did everything right and came up short. It's called It's Much Too Late. I never kicked a dog, a child, or my wife. I never looked at pornography. I swear it on my holy saint mother's life, but somehow she's down here with me. The road to hell is littered with nice guys with good intentions. But once you're there, you're there. It's much too late. I can cry and scream. It's just not fair to leave me here like you just don't care. There must be some mistake up there in heaven. Now it's much too late. My time has passed away. All my plans and dreams have all ended. Now it's much too late to try and plead my case, and I don't know the God I've offended. It's too late. I never stole a thing, a toy or a kiss. My conscience is as clean as can be, and when I was a teen, all the sex that I missed wasn't abstinence a blessing to me. The road to hell is littered with nice guys with good intentions, but once you're there, you're there. It's much too late. I can cry and scream. It's just not fair to leave me here like you don't care. There must be some mistake up there in heaven. Now it's much too late. My time has passed away. All my plans and dreams have all ended. Now it's much too late to try and plead my case, and I don't know the God I've offended. It's much too late. You can do all the right things for all the wrong reasons, and it means nothing. It starts with the heart. Remember Samuel's words to Saul, to obey is better than sacrifice. And one of my favorite gospel singers died in 1982 in a plane crash. His name was Keith Green. Tremendous prophet for my generation. And he wrote a song by that name, To Obey is Better Than Sacrifice. And I'd like to play that for you just before we close. He says, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. They're the ones who get the blessings. To get up, you've got to go down. But here's the good news, and Gene read it for us before. Come to me, all your labor and are burdened down, and I'll give you rest. There's the promise. There's the hope. Let's pray. Father, you know our hearts. Let our hearts be completely surrendered to you. Let us trust you. Lord, no matter how many times we fail, we know that you'll forgive. You'll restore us. Your love is amazing and so good to us, God. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.